What's up, wrestling fans? It is time for another edition of The Voice of Wrestling. I am your host, Chris Cash, and I'm looking forward to an awesome, awesome show tonight. Plenty to talk about, and of course, as always, I'm joined by the man, Nick Paglino, who, by the way, I don't know if anybody noticed this. I'm going out on a limb here. I'm positive I saw him. Nick, were you at the pay-per-view last night?
I was, indeed. I was there. I was actually at NXT TakeOver on Saturday night, and I was at Royal Rumble last night, yeah.
That's impressive. So I was watching. I was over at David's, who, by the way, guys, another edition of David Dishes later on towards the end of the show. You can stick around for that before we head into Monday Night Raw. David, my cousin, is going to come on, give us his thoughts on the show. Recorded that a little bit earlier. But I was over there watching the show last night, and
let me guess, you saw me pop huge for Nikki Bella.
I saw you pop huge for Nikki Bella, and I was like, that looked like Nick. And of course, I wasn't able to like rewind it and find out. And then Will, of course, the guy that does all of our stuff over for VLW, said, yeah, look, like Nick was on the show. I'm like, really, that was him? Okay, I had no idea. So there you go.
Yeah, I had four text messages all at once that said, bro, you just pop huge for Nikki Bella on the network, and there's no way they can edit that out.
No, you can't. You know what? You could call up Vince and be like, Vince, do me a solid. I look like a dork.
Come on, man.
Please.
Hey, no, I'm owning up to it, man. I'm a big Bella Twins fan. I don't care.
Okay, I mean, was that they just caught you at that one particular time? Were you popping for everybody?
Throughout the rest of the
show. Okay.
It was that one moment.
Nikki Bella comes out and Nick's like, yes.
And then the show starts.
Then the show started for you. Okay. Well, look, I want to go ahead and get on my hype, you know, a little bit, my little soapbox, my high horse right now.
I was reading some of your tweets today, so I'm looking forward to this discussion.
So, look, you were there live, and I mean, that's going to make this even more interesting because there's always that dynamic of what I see, you know, what we see on television versus being there live, and that's going to make it very difficult for us to really compare apples to apples here.
Well, and just so you know, though,
have you watched it?
I rewatched the whole show today.
More than just that one spot of just more than just that one spot of you, though.
To get that, you know, that television fan perspective as well as the live perspective.
Okay, so at least you got to watch it both, so that's going to be good. Yeah. Let me check, make sure. By the way, guys, if you want, make sure get in the chat room, voiceofwrestling.net, or go to our YouTube channel. Voice of Wrestling, or it's VLW Radio on YouTube. So youtube.com/VLW Radio. Join the chat room there. I am there. Hopefully everything's going okay. The stream seems to be having maybe some issues. I'm trying to make sure here. I'm going to. Can everybody hear? Nick, are you there? Can you see it on there?
Am I looking at the stream?
Yeah, go look at the stream on YouTube. Just make sure
it's
okay.
Look at it. Yeah.
Yeah, check it. Just make sure. Go there and find out. And I'm going to go ahead and start, talking. We are recording this, so if it has to go out a little, I can upload it later. But it does seem like something might be wrong with the stream. So look, first and foremost, I didn't hate last night's show. I don't want anybody to think that. But I will say that I thought it was more than lackluster, especially the Men's Rumble. I think there were some good things that came out of last night's pay-per-view that we're going to talk about tonight. But I felt like, I mean, I saw on Twitter people talking about just the Rumble match itself, that there was, like, in their head, it was top five, maybe top 10, top 10. Again, that's top third, so we can talk about that. But, I mean, really putting over the pay-per-view as this amazing, amazing pay-per-view. And
I would go so far as to say maybe the best Rumble match I've ever seen, but, you know.
Okay, so, no, we're going to argue then, because I want to know what possibly could make that show. And let's just start with you being there live. You watched it back on tape. What on earth, first and foremost, would make you think that it's top of all time, maybe the best Rumble you've ever seen? Just give me some actual details, though, some highlights.
Well, first of all, I think it was just booked perfectly.
Like, you know, what?
Difficult.
Normally in the Rumble, you have these dynamics of you know, men that you haven't seen square off, and they have their time in the ring where they're squaring off. You've got, look, outside of Heath Slater, who I wish they would have just taken that the entire length of the pay-per-view. I think that would have been, or the Rumble match where he's not able to make it into the ring. And then finally, once he finally gets,
it would have been great if
all 29 people beat the hell out of him before, at least whoever came after him, until he finally made it to the ring. And then he got his ass booted within 2 seconds. That would have been awesome. There was some fun parts like that. Elias's part I thought was decent, but from like 1 to 15, I don't remember every number that came out. So, but 1 to 15, 1 to 16, it was just lackluster. I mean, they saved every surprise for the most part and every big name for the end. You had Dolph be number 30, which I was actually okay with. That gave me a good odds on the possibility of him winning the damn thing, him being in the match. So that was nice of them. But at the end of the day, to have him come back and get put out by a guy like Balor, who really hasn't been given his just due and freaking hoop, except for recently with the Balor Club. But other than that, like, tell me what moment specifically, if you think it was booked and formatted so properly, what was it? It was boring. It really,
from top to bottom, it was excellent. The Heath Slater stuff was great. You got to see some great individual match rivalries play out. Wyatt and Matt Hardy working together was brilliant for that couple of minutes before then they took each other out. Really getting that moment of, you know, again, you're in a city in which Roman Reigns won the Royal Rumble a few years back. The city absolutely hated it. People that watched it on television hated it. So whenever you come to a major market like a Philadelphia or a New York or a Chicago, you have a major challenge of not only booking the show so that everyone watching at home likes it, but you have to book the show so that the live crowd likes it. And they booked this perfectly, I think, for both audiences. The Philadelphia crowd loved it because they got to see Roman Reigns, John Cena acting as the heels in the match because they would be. And when you had that moment, you know, you had an incredible surprise return in Rey Mysterio. He looked phenomenal.
He did,
you
know, look good. That was a good spot. There's nothing wrong with that.
Tonight, I thought everyone that returned, including the women in the women's Royal Rumble matches, they all looked fantastic. They all looked like they hadn't skipped a beat, missed a beat. They were in great shape.
That's a stretch. That's a stretch.
I loved seeing the three of them pitted up against Roman Reigns and you know, Finn Balor, the new guys versus the old breed. I really, really liked that.
See,
I thought the eliminations were great. Really, honestly, the only problem I had with the whole Royal Rumble, and this was my prediction before last week, is they once again absolutely wasted Dolph Ziggler. They did nothing with Dolph Ziggler. And if that didn't prove to you that this company is done with Dolph Ziggler, then I don't know
what proof you need that WWE
is not using this guy for anything.
No, yeah, ever. It's hard to argue. It's hard to argue after that. I think, look, here's the problem. I think people overestimate the casual fans and what they think about A, NXT guys, B, New Japan, like the new breed, old, you know, old guys type of thing, as far as, you know, obviously Finn Balor and his crew and everything. Like, to me, people don't know Finn Balor outside of WWE. And I'm just talking about in a general sense, by the way. I'm not talking.
That wasn't a New Japan thing.
I'm talking about.
Finn Balor's been around long enough where WWE fans know who he is.
No, I'm not saying that Finn Balor isn't known beyond just New Japan and the Balor and the Bullet Club and everything. I'm saying, though, that I think here's the problem. Internet darlings, you know, that the internet wrestling fans, like, obviously, I was rooting for Roman Reigns by the end of this pay-per-view, like at the end of the match. I was rooting and cheering it on for him because, you know what? Roman Reigns is going to be given the time, the energy. He's not some fly-by-night kid that they're throwing out there to see. Look, Nakamura deserves it. It's great. It's fun. The Philly crowd. But you cannot cater to your live audiences with major decisions. Like, who's going to go on to WrestleMania?
I don't think they did, though.
No, not, well, number one, Nakamura winning is catering. You're catering to the internet.
Nakamura teased a singles match in the Elimination Chamber, or excuse me, the Money in the Bank ladder match. The fans went nuts. People want to see that match. I mean, you could.
I'm not disagreeing that AJ Styles and Nakamura.
Are you uninterested in AJ Styles versus Nakamura?
No, but here's the problem with character development: that a long-term character. I think wrestling fans these days, especially hardcore, and more people are becoming smarter these days. That's just a natural fact. Okay. That's obvious anymore. It's a foregone conclusion at this point that wrestling fans in general are going to be getting their news from places like ProWrestling.com and Voice of Wrestling and the PW Insiders and all these guys of the world. They're going to find them a lot easier now because of social media and everything like that. Here's the problem, though. I think that the environment that's creating now is I think attention span in general. And this is why, you know, as much as I've hated WWE and Vince McMahon for sticking to his guns on things that I hated, I just didn't like. Look, at the end of the day, building stars is something that does take time and money and energy and real development. When you think about the old days and Steve Austin and The Rock, Bret Hart, Shawn Michaels, how long were these guys up at the top? You know, they were there for John Cena, obviously. How long have these guys been put up at the top? And let's look in like the last 5 years, Nick. All right. Just because every single year somebody comes along that the fans are like, you should have seen this guy in New Japan. You should have seen this guy in NXT. Who gives a shit? Like, it doesn't matter until they make it to the grand stage. It doesn't matter.
I understand the argument of, you should have seen this guy here or there, when that doesn't matter anymore because they're in WWE now. But I don't understand how this in any way applies to a Finn Balor. It's not like they were putting this over as, oh, it's John Cena passing the torch to New Japan star Finn Balor. It's Finn Balor has been in WWE for a while now. He's he was an NXT champion. He's a bona fide main event guy now.
WWE
hasn't been using him well.
Right.
Not push these guys.
No. Push them.
You've got Shinsuke Nakamura.
Push them
on the main roster.
Push them.
It's not like Shinsuke Nakamura was brought up last week to get a Royal Rumble win.
He's
been on the main roster now for a while, and the fans have been wanting something from him. Do something with the guy. Okay, you give him the Royal Rumble win. Give him a dream match. That a lot of people, even if you are, look, you could say everything you're saying right now, you could make that argument about AJ Styles. He's a New Japan guy. He's a Ring of Honor guy. He's a TNA guy.
But let's, all right, look, we could go down the list.
Booked him that way, and the fans love it. The casual fans love AJ Styles.
We could go down the list. I love AJ Styles. I think AJ Styles is absolutely incredible. They're likening him to Shawn Michaels at this point. I think that's a stretch. But here's the thing. Go down the list of guys that have come and gone from top to wherever they're actually going to be in just the past 5 years. I take a guy like, for example, you know, Bray Wyatt. You know, if given the consistency that that someone like Roman Reigns is being given now or whatever the case may be, I think he's a very good example of someone that could have done something, right? I mean, he's been given a huge run when he first came out. There's a number of these guys that I think are in that same vein. You know, they get the internet loves them, and then they get out there and then WWE does something with them only to pull the rug out months later, and before you know it, they're going through a song and dance like with Matt Hardy that's really kind of been a big flop, obviously, with Matt, not so much Bray's fight, but or his fault. But you know, here's to develop. I mean, I remember talking, somebody was saying just bringing up Roman Reigns, which I think this is just as much to do with Roman Reigns not winning the Rumble as it is Nakamura actually winning the Rumble. But the idea of Roman winning the Rumble last night again is just, people were going to riot. They would have absolutely blown a gasket if he won that match. And why, Nick? Why? I mean, why is it? I mean, they did it to John Cena. John Cena was an internet fan, but then they just got bored with him, and now everybody hates him, you know, like a big majority of people do. And now same thing with Roman Reigns. Roman was organically getting over until WWE just started forcing him down their throats, which I understand. But that is how you get people over. You get them up on top, and you put them up on top, and you keep them there.
So, all right. I mean, if who was supposed to win that Royal Rumble match then last night? Because remember, even though, first of all, it can't be John Cena. He's not the future of the company anymore.
I agree with that.
You don't have to give the match. We agreed on this last week. You didn't. There was no need for a Roman Reigns.
No. Look, this is not against Nakamura.
No matter what.
This is not my. I don't have an issue with Nakamura winning, as predictable as it was. I mean, both Rumbles were kind of predictable, but safe bets. And I think obviously it shapes up what they're doing. And sometimes I think they just throw things against the wall for no reason. So I'm not. Look, I'm okay with Nakamura. I think he's gonna. I think he's you know, a fun character. I think he's gonna be interesting. I don't know how far he can really go with kind of the language barrier and cutting promos being such a, to me, a huge part in character development and really getting over and resonating with fans on a emotional level. But people like him, and they've told a really good story so far with him. I think that's fine. I have no issue with that. But here's my, as far as my biggest issue is just the Rumble match itself. I don't agree that it was laid out very well. I thought it was really lackluster in those huge moments that you expect out of the Rumble. You know, I really just thought it was very boring for that first half. And then it finally, honestly, the moment that I thought, and I remember looking at David and Brett, and I was thinking, this is kind of where the Rumble started for me, was when Cena comes out and they all stop to then beat his ass like that. But it didn't last very long, and I wish it would have lasted a little bit longer. But at the same time, that was the part where I'm like, you know what, that was really a good spot. That was when the Rumble actually started for me, because everything up to that part was so lackluster to me. It was just boring. And I know that some people are in agreement with me, and then half of the people seems like they absolutely loved it. And then here's what I think the biggest issue is. A, they were really scared that a guy like Cena or Roman Reigns was going to win it. They wanted to see one of these new fresh faces like Nakamura win it. They want to set up the match with AJ Styles. They had that in their head, and it was Daniel Bryan all over again. This year was going to Nakamura, and if it didn't happen, fans were going to be pissed, and the Rumble would have been ruined for all of them. That's how it was. They had it made up in their mind, and if it didn't go that way, they're pissed off. But as far as the match itself, to say, and I got this when I was tweeting back and forth with people, you know, right after the pay-per-view or during it, to say that because we've had three or four bad years of pay-per-views, and this is the first, you know, the first decent Royal Rumble match in 3 or 4 years, it gets, you know, put way up here. That's ridiculous to me. Look, call every Royal Rumble bad if you want to, but don't make this one that much better because you feel like the other three or four were just way down here under the rocks and buried.
I'm not making the argument. Last night's match was great because it was a great match.
You're saying it was maybe the best you've seen.
To me, it didn't have anything to do. I wasn't comparing it to something else. For me, last night's match was great because it was great. So, you know, I haven't seen people claiming that last night's match was good because other ones.
But I have, and I think that's the issue. I think it's standards being lowered, and I also think that it's such an immense hatred for guys that I don't care what people say. It doesn't matter how much they boo him. It doesn't matter how much they write about his weaknesses. Roman Reigns is going on to WrestleMania and will likely win the title there. And fans need to start getting on board with it. I wish WWE would just simply let him just absolutely go heel. I mean, I think it's actually working for a guy like Jason Jordan right now. Like, I hated that guy. He was just bland, and he was just another really reincarnation of The Rock. But here we are now. He's actually getting over with major heat right now. I mean, they've done a good job because they let him embrace it, and fans love to boo him.
Well, you let these guys embrace who they actually are. That's the problem, I think, with Roman Reigns. Look at Rusev. Rusev was pushed for so long as this big angry monster, which is not who he really is in real life. He's actually a pretty silly, funny guy.
Yeah.
And now they're letting him do that with this Rusev Day thing, and it's getting over. I mean, look how simple it is. You know, but again, though, a lot of that I think is WWE. I think, it, you know, you want to call it an ego thing, maybe. The WWE creative team, Vince, whoever's in charge, saying, well, you know, if you do it yourself, then we can't take credit for it. But, you know, we have to create the character for you.
Sure,
you know,
which sure.
I think it's ridiculous. Any star that's been a legitimate star in pro wrestling will have, they've all gone on record in interviews as saying, what? It's that phrase, my character in the ring was myself with the volume turned up, you know?
Right.
So it was
always just
a version of themselves and how they connect with people on a realistic level.
Correct.
Gets them over. And I think that's why people aren't digging Roman Reigns, because it's this forced Superman character that he is. They did the exact same thing with John Cena. They're always trying to, they're always making that top babyface the same character. And people don't want to see that. It's why they love Daniel Bryan, because he wasn't cookie cutter. He was that anti-hero almost. So, you know, and Shinsuke Nakamura is extremely unique. And I think he connects with fans. Here's a guy who can't speak the language very well, yet he can communicate in ways that resonates with all audiences, no matter what language you speak. And I think that's what people are picking up on.
Well, and I feel like it's going to, I mean, it's way too early to tell, number one. And I feel like with the developmental system that we have in place for WWE right now, and they're moving people through there so quickly, and people debut, and you get guys coming from NXT because it's its own universe, right? It's its own universe, and the fans are being, you know, they're bred differently now, too, with the WWE network and just 24/7 stream. I think that's, I want to get off of this, though, because it is something that I obviously, you know, you and I aren't going to agree necessarily on, and that's fine. Everybody has their own taste. I'm not mad at anybody for liking.
Well, that's the tough thing. But you know what, Chris? That's the tough thing about the Rumble, is that much like wrestling in general, people love different things about the Rumble.
100%. You know,
100%. We've talked about this before.
Yep.
Some people love the surprise returns. That's
sure.
all they care about. Some people care only about who's going to be number 30, who's going to be number one. Some people love when there are a multitude of guys in the ring at the same time.
Right, right.
You know, they love it when there's 10, 12 guys all battling at the same time. Other people don't like that.
Sure.
They prefer
they
when there's only maybe
four or five,
two,
maybe at
three
the most.
Guys
right,
in the
right,
ring
right.
at one time, because it gets too cluttered.
Yeah.
Some people like the personal rivalries
sure.
there.
I do.
Some people aren't necessarily as interested in that. Some people really can't wait to see what Kofi Kingston's going to do. Other people don't care as much about that. Some people love the comedy aspect of the Royal Rumble, like the Heath Slater business or things they've done where who's going to get eliminated in 2 seconds, like Sheamus. Other people don't like comedy in their Royal Rumble match, and they like it more serious. So I think it also comes down to what, you know, there are a lot of different things you can like about the Rumble match. And I think if this was a match that played to your tastes, then you would like it. If it wasn't, then you're not.
But see, and I think that's the issue, though. Like, to me, the Rumble is the Rumble because of that. You never know who's coming out next.
Right.
Part of it. The surprise aspect is huge.
So many of those.
And in the women's match we did. I mean, the men's match, I don't know that we got a ton. I mean,
but you can't look. The match has to mean something. It can't be.
Nakamura won the damn thing. That means quite a bit.
Because then it becomes a match about surprises as opposed to a match about
no.
to legitimately see winning this match from a current roster.
Standpoint. Okay,
if
Nick. Then if
Slaughter returning is not going to win the match.
All right, Nick, if that's what you think, let me ask you a question then. If that's how you feel, because number one, I think it's a combination. It's not just the surprises that makes a Royal Rumble match good to me. Although I think the women's match, the women's Royal Rumble, despite the fact that a lot of the girls where you say they didn't miss a beat, I think almost every single one of them botched about five spots in their first. Like, to me, they didn't look near as good. A couple of them did, but a lot of them were very, very rusty, and it was obvious. And it was very difficult for women to get over the top rope. That was another issue that I found. But other than that, I think the women's Royal Rumble match was 10 times better than the men's. I mean, I really felt like just the whole idea of it was very, very good. And you got a lot of nostalgia from women coming out. Some of them did look obviously really good. Others were a little rusty, but they did their job. They did their job to come in and put these other people over, the stars of today. I felt like that was very, very interesting. Beth, like the moments of the Royal Rumbles that I love were the moments just like Beth Phoenix and Nia Jax. Like, that was great to me. That, you know, lifting her up. I mean, you kind of got the Hulk Hogan and you know, Yokozuna type of effect. I mean, all of that. That stuff is good. I don't think there was enough of it in the Rumble, unfortunately, for me, for my taste. It was just kind of run-of-the-mill, very mundane, and then very predictable. And even though I don't mind the outcome, it was just, if you're going to make it that predictable, and everybody kind of assumes Nakamura probably goes over in this thing, then at least make everything else, you know, lead up to that where it is a little bit unpredictable, and there just wasn't enough unpredictability in my mind for me to really get into it. But there's obviously a lot more to talk about too. So let's talk about some of these other things that took place. First and foremost, real quickly, Nick, AJ Styles retained in kind of a controversial fashion. The more and more I think about our conversations from last week, Nick, and everything, I really feel like it would have been a better choice at this point. With AJ's being, he's sky high right now. I don't feel like he needed to have the title for this next month or two until get to Mania with the title. There was enough opportunities for them to do that. And Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn aren't necessarily hurt by this. I'm not one of those that believe anybody necessarily get hurt by one loss. But I feel like the way that was shaping up, and the more now that I think about it in retrospect, too, after the fact, I really think they could have done some very genius storyline, creative shit with these two as the co-champions. And I don't know that you got another opportunity for that, obviously, especially before Mania. So I wish they would have gone in a different direction. But just overall, what did you think of the outcome, and what did you think of the match?
It was a good match. You know, it was
it wasn't bad. Yeah,
match. You know, I think Owens and Zayn are great enough as heels in their current roles that the loss isn't going to hurt them that much. But I mean, man, how the hell am I supposed to take these two guys seriously when two of your top SmackDown stars can't beat one guy?
Yep.
You know, two guys?
Yep.
Can't beat AJ Styles? I mean, that's odd to me. You know, I can't. How am I ever supposed to believe now, if I ever see AJ Styles versus Zayn or AJ Styles versus Owens, that they would ever have a chance of beating him when two of them combined can't beat him?
100%. So yeah.
I never like that idea of a babyface killing a billion heels, because then it just makes them individually, it makes them all look that much weaker.
Yep.
But I don't want to sit here and say that, you know, it didn't bury them. I'm not going to go that far, but, you know, I don't know. I personally thought it was going to be some kind of a DQ thing, or, you know, there wasn't going to be any kind of a clean finish or something like that.
Well, and I think, look, it depends on who it is. Two heels can be beaten up by a baby face if you're not looking at those heels as being number one draws.
I mean, look.
And I don't know that I look at Sami Zayn. He's a lot better in this role than he's been in a long, long time to me. But Kevin Owens is a guy that I'm very high on. I know a lot of people are. I think he's very, very good. And he's one of those that I've watched a special of his on the network, and he's a perfectionist, man. I mean, he's up and down. Yeah. Like, he gets depressed if he's not where he wants to be. You know, like, he really does. He eats, sleeps, and breathes this business and his own gimmick, obviously. He wants to outdo himself over and over and again. You can kind of see that in his work. Sure. He seems to be, I don't know. You know, I don't have a clue what he feels about this whole thing. He seems to be enjoying himself working with one of his best friends. Obviously, that seems to be something that's up his alley. But where does it go? And that's what if this ultimately just leads to a Sami Zayn, Kevin Owens feud, which you assume it very well could at some point down the line, it's not worth it to me. But allowing this to get one of them, and cream rises to the top. So if Sami Zayn came out of this better off than Owens, I wouldn't be upset if it made sense. But I think Kevin Owens has the bigger upside, at least in my mind, as a massive star down the line. And I feel like they need to give him that opportunity. I feel like the more and more they lose together like this, like last night, the more it hurts Kevin's stock. Not so much Sammy's, because I don't know that I see Sammy the look, everything just really is very, very just kind of mundane and just kind of run of the mill. I don't look at him as a massive star, but he is doing a lot better in this gimmick, and I think that's great for him. This is lifting him up. I don't know if it's lifting Kevin Owens up from where he used to be, where he was expected to be. And so I think last night, again, the match was okay. They really almost didn't pull off that controversial finish. I mean, the tag was way too close. You could see Kevin Owens having to literally lean or like move his hand so he couldn't get tagged. But either way, I agree with you. I don't think the loss necessarily hurts them, but it's very evident at this point. AJ Styles, Nakamura, probably, I don't think anything changes between now and WrestleMania. They have a huge stage at WrestleMania to get over with an amazing match. here's my only thing. And Nick, I'm, you know, you and I think have always agreed on entertainment over technical wrestling. Like, that's just, I know I am big on that. And I know sometimes you kind of go either way, but I think storytelling between AJ Styles and Nakamura has to be good, man. These are two guys that everybody loves right now. That can be tricky for them. You've got a long time to build. If that's still the plan, that's going to be the plan. You got a long time between now and WrestleMania for these guys to get some heat in some form or fashion. It just can't be a love fest all the way through. I mean, this can't be two guys coming together to put on an amazing match that'll draw for one night for about 20 minutes, and then the rest of it doesn't matter anymore. Like, to me, you've got to build these guys up, because I'm old school when it comes to I want superstars, and I think Styles is on the verge. I think he's in a good spot, and I like Nakamura because he's different. But let's go back in history, guys. Guys like Nakamura generally don't stay on top for very long, so enjoy it now. You know, I'm not saying that's right or wrong, but I am saying the very few times are you going to see him as your world champion year after year after year. Enjoy this rise of Nakamura right now, because if I were a betting man, I'd put all my money that it's very short-lived in the grand scheme of things. He'll be back into kind of a mid-card B player at some point here relatively soon. But I am looking forward to seeing if they can create a storyline that really gets people invested beyond just these guys are going to tear it up in the ring. We've got NXT for that. We've got the indies. WWE, the reason they are where they are, and I'll always go back to this, is because characters outweigh everything else. Superstars, The Rock, Cena, Stone Cold, Hulk Hogan, for God's sake. I mean, the prime example of that. Yes, sometimes you strike lightning and you get a Ric Flair who can go in the ring and can be amazing on the mic, or a Steve Austin who's a good in-ring guy and awesome at character development, but it's not very often. I mean, AJ Styles has struggled with that his entire career, and he's now getting to a point where you can tell he's very comfortable on the mic, but is he wowing people with promos? No, he's not. So how far can he go too is still up in the air for me, but nevertheless, it's going to be interesting to see where they go with that, and obviously what happens with Kevin Owens. That storyline is clearly not over between Kevin Owens. Do you see Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, Nick, getting another title shot between now and Mania together?
I don't think they'll get a title shot, no.
Do you think the title comes off of AJ?
And we had talked about this before. You know, the next SmackDown exclusive pay-per-view is going to be Fastlane. The early match advertisements there is a fatal five-way,
right,
with AJ Styles defending against Orton, Nakamura, Zayn, and Owens. So I think they'll get that title shot, but I don't think it's just going to be the two of them. You never know. You could see on a SmackDown Live maybe Styles versus Owens one-on-one, maybe for the title, but I don't see that happening. I see them kind of still sticking with this Owens and Zayn tandem for a while, and really I think it's just gonna just sort of buy us time until we get to AJ Styles versus Nakamura at WrestleMania.
I don't really want to spend a ton of time on the tag team. Obviously, they wanted to break up Seth Rollins and Jason Jordan. If they're ready, they're ready. That's fine. The bar is the chat, which the bar's been beaten up so much lately, too. It's really hard to care about them as the tag team champions. In my mind, I don't see it. I like those guys in a lot of ways, and I think they work good together, too. But I'm just not real enthused about I just don't care about that. Now, Jason Jordan stuff has really surprised me. He's doing some decent things. You know, his mannerisms, his care, he's into it, man. You can tell he's so comfortable in this role, and it's working to his favor. So I'm kind of curious to see where they go with that, because he, without a question, has been the benefactor of this entire story. Everybody else is kind of being drugged down on his level, but he's rose up, and it's good for him in that regard. But I'm still not putting a lot of stock into Jason Jordan at this point. But let's jump over to obviously huge news. Talk about the Women's Rumble. Nick, I mean, how did you compare it just being there live? Obviously, besides marking out like a little schoolgirl to Nikki Bella, what did you think side by side? The, you know, main eventing last night's pay-per-view, clearly, which I think took some people by surprise, including myself. Yeah. I didn't see that happening. But What did you think overall? Let's not talk about Ronda Rousey yet. Let's just talk specifically about the match itself. Tons of women coming back. Tons of returns. I mean, Kelly, Tori Wilson, Lita, Beth Phoenix, like I mentioned. Obviously, Molly Holly. I mean, the list goes on. Half of the damn roster almost was women returning. But So, Nick, what did you – I mean, how did you rank this compared to the men's match itself?
Well, different. You know, I thought it was brilliant. You know, I thought it was just a – clearly it was just a big celebration of all of the women that have contributed. You know, I think something that people don't understand, and I'm not saying this solely – I mean, I've thought about this on my own before, but I was listening to an interview not too long ago with a former WWE writer by the name of Tom Cassiello, and he was talking about how much flack a lot of – and this is probably one of the reasons why I like Nikki Bella so much, or the Bella twins in general, is because a lot of those girls of that time – were put in very, very difficult positions. They were not trained wrestlers. They were bikini models that were picked up out of catalogs or swimsuit magazines, and they were shoved in the middle of a wrestling ring and told, do this. And then they were the ones that got blamed when the matches weren't good. So, you know, they were the divas, the Michelle McCools, the Kelly Kellys, the Marias, the Bella Twins. These are girls that were paraded out there to be nothing more than hot, to be nothing more than looking good in skimpy outfits.
True.
And then they're the ones that took all the blame when the matches weren't good and when they would botch and when it would look terrible. You know, and now you've got the girls of today, like the Becky Lynches and the Natalias and the Sasha Banks and Bayley, and oh, you know, these women are so much better, but it's because they were allowed to be. They were given the training. They WWE was going out there and actively finding athletes as opposed to models, you know. And so I think it was really cool to give some of those girls, you know, and girls like Trish Stratus and Lita, who had to fight really hard to say we're more than just,
sure,
you know, Lita
sure.
was more than just a sex segment in the middle of the ring with Edge. You know, she's a wrestler, you know, and they were able to prove that. But they were really only two. They were a small amount of girls that were allowed to get that kind of recognition. And now you're seeing it more. So to bring them back, to bring Michelle McCool back and the Beth Phoenix, who a lot of people always thought was underused and not used properly because she was a girl that could go, but she was in a time, she came around in a time where women's wrestling was nothing.
Sure.
WWE didn't care about women's wrestling.
True.
She really didn't get many opportunities to shine. So I think and so I really, really appreciate girls like the Bella Twins who have worked so hard to get better. And they got better. They got a lot better. You know, Brie, when she was training with Daniel Bryan, she got so much better in the ring.
Sure.
I mean, they're both good, talented.
They really are. Yeah, they've come a long way.
And that was because of their own hard work that got them there. You know, Daniel Bryan working with the, you know, Nikki probably working with John Cena, working with people that really wanted to help them, could help them, and they wanted to be helped. They wanted to learn. And I give them a lot of credit. I really applaud. Those are girls who could have just rode the beauty thing for as long as they wanted. They probably never really needed to learn how to wrestle, but they did. And I have to applaud them for that. And other girls like Kelly, who, you know, look at how she started. She was pole dancing on ECW. That was her role in the company. And she worked hard. And yeah, she's not the best wrestler in the world.
That's true.
But she worked as hard as she could to get as good as she could be.
Yeah.
And for that, I have to applaud them. And I think WWE, this was WWE's way of thanking those girls by bringing them back, giving them their moments. My God, Michelle McCool had the most, she was one of the best looking ones in the match.
Yeah,
she had five eliminations.
No, she looked good.
You know? Yeah. She came back looking great. And I think this match was WWE's way of saying, here's the future, because Asuka won. Asuka's going to go on to WrestleMania. The future is Ronda Rousey, which you got after the match. But during the match, it was a celebration of all the women who have contributed to the point that the WWE women are at today.
And we're going to talk about...
I really love it.
And we're going to talk about Rousey in a minute. I think they could have done more with some of the bigger names. Lita, Trish, the passing of the torch, so to speak. I really think they could have probably had those girls, Michelle McCool, especially because they look good. Lita looked good. Trish looked good. I think they could have done more. You know, maybe not so much with like a Tori Wilson, or but like a Molly Holly who can still work. And at some point had 5-6 girls from that era, 5-6 girls from the new one, squaring off at the kind of towards the tail end. I think Lita could have made it a little longer. I think Trish could have made it a little bit longer. I think Michelle obviously really surprised me by how long she went, but and how many eliminations she ultimately got. But I thought, again, that match was booked better to me, obviously, based on what I've said, than the men's. I think it was pretty well done overall. And look, you knew there was going to be some botched spots. You knew that there was going to be some ring rust from as many women as they brought back. And there definitely was.
It's the first time these women are doing a match like
that's what I'm saying. And so you knew
men have experience.
You knew that they were going to have some tough times, but they got creative with a lot of it. I thought the last few minutes of that match was really, really good. But no, I thought it did its job, and I agree with you. Putting the spotlight on them the way that they did, it really does bring the women to kind of a different level than they already have become at this point. I think they've done a really good job with this revolution for women, and I feel like they've managed to build them up to people. Look, the fans still don't care, and I don't mean to say this harshly, but they still don't care about the women like they do the men. That's a given. It's not going to happen overnight by any stretch, but as society changes, and of course, they keep bringing in these women that literally do have actual in-ring talent before they ever set foot in the WWE ring, and then you give them these characters, which of course they're doing every single night, putting them in main events on a main event stage, literally in the main event. I think it's just a matter of time, and I feel like someone like Asuka is a good one to kind of, and Charlotte Flair, by the way, who's just to me phenomenal in her role. I think she's absolutely one of the best women to come along in a very, very, very long time. So I like where they're headed. I think it's going to be interesting. Let's go ahead and jump into Ronda Rousey though, because here's the thing. I think it was waiting until after the match. A lot of people were thinking maybe she could actually show up. Waiting until that was great. And I think you thought the pay-per-view was over, and then here she comes. But now, Nick, and I'm sure on ProWrestling.com, you've reported this, it seems like maybe they're thinking a different direction. And the idea is she signed a multi-year deal, so we know she's here to stay. Her quotes even say, look, I'm putting everything into this. This is my life. And that's great on her part. She's a lifelong fan. I think she's going to do phenomenal in here. She is, without a question, the biggest superstar for the women's division that I think has ever existed. She will draw I don't know that she's going to bring a ton of MMA fans over or anything, but wrestling fans will get into this just like they have Brock Lesnar. I think she's the female version of Brock without a question, just because of the similarities and some of the background. She's a legit badass. I mean, she's going, and WrestleMania with The Rock really showcased that. Last night, I don't think it was too much smiling. It didn't make a lot of sense. She points to WrestleMania, and now there's reports, Nick, that goes against everything you assumed. You assume it's probably Asuka and Alexa Bliss, and you assume it's probably Charlotte and Ronda Rousey. And maybe we're going to get that, but now there's new reports coming out that we could get some sort of tag team match with Triple H and Stephanie McMahon against Rousey and potentially The Rock if they can get it, potentially Braun Strowman, who there's been rumors of Braun Strowman versus The Miz, which we can talk about in a minute because I think that's a bad idea in for a lot of reasons. But the notion that you have to give Ronda Rousey time to ease in is ridiculous. If you like this storyline better, go with it. But don't say that she needs time to ease into a match, because if she's not ready to be in the ring, don't put her in the ring. And the fact that she has been training this long already, they've put women into matches well with a lot less training than I'm sure she's already had and will continue to get by all the best people WWE can put in front of her. Between now and Mania, there's enough time for her and Charlotte Flair to put together an incredible match if that's the way they wanted to go. And I'm not arguing that I think it should be Charlotte Flair, but I do think this, Ronda Rousey's first match at WrestleMania needs to have a purpose, Nick. WrestleMania is going to draw regardless. Stephanie McMahon and Triple H and The Rock potentially certainly doesn't need the rub from Ronda Rousey. Charlotte Flair or someone of that, you know, of that caliber could absolutely use the rub from a massive main event match that it would be against, you know, against Ronda Rousey. So why the setup like it had it last night, Nick, if you're even contemplating and thinking about not putting her against either one of those, which is what you would assume? You know, you've got those three girls in the ring. She comes out, points to WrestleMania. You would think it's against one of those three people, but yet now we're hearing that maybe they're going to go and the bogus excuse of easing her into a match. Bullshit. That's just them wanting to have some high-profile match and what. But I don't know that. I'm not going to say Triple H and Steph are doing this because they need to be in the spotlight, or I don't think that necessarily. But I don't think it's necessarily the best use of your resources at this point, with the first mega match at WrestleMania with Ronda Rousey, to go against, you know, to have three other people in the match that are not going to really be helped or elevated by this. Let it be Charlotte at this point. I guess I am arguing that it should be Charlotte.
Well, yeah. But, well, it's look, the bottom line is this, it seems pretty obvious. And remember, Asuka did not make her decision.
No, she didn't.
Unlike Shinsuke Nakamura,
right,
who announced live who he was going to face at Mania.
True.
We did not get that from Asuka. Why? They're leaving their options open. WWE will always, always at WrestleMania, because remember, they don't consider WrestleMania a monthly pay-per-view. That's continuing storylines. WrestleMania is its own special attraction.
True, yep.
The more celebrities they can pour into a match, they're going to do that. If they could potentially have The Rock, Ronda Rousey, think about this. You've got one of the biggest athletes in the world teaming up with the biggest Hollywood star in the world right now. WWE's jumping on that all day long. Does it make the most sense for the future of storylines, for the future of their company? No. Charlotte belongs in that role against Ronda Rousey, so you could really help. You know, look, major news, mainstream media sites are going to cover this no matter what, because Ronda Rousey is involved. So like you said, let Charlotte Flair get that rub, but WWE is not going to look at it like that.
True.
They can get more mainstream coverage out of The Rock.
That's true. That's
with true. Ronda Rousey, they're going to go that route for the sake of the pay-per-view, for the sake of the publicity, for the sake of the mainstream coverage. Every outlet, every movie website, every sports website, everyone will be all over The Rock and Rousey together.
And
they're going to go that route. So what this tells me is that they probably don't know what The Rock's schedule is yet. They
leaving it open.
Don't know if The Rock is available.
They're just leaving it open for that possibility. Yeah.
You know, in 3 weeks, 4 weeks, if The Rock says I can do it, then boom, you announce, you go that route.
Right.
If Rock tells you in 3 to 4 weeks, I'm out, I got to shoot that day, or the producing company of this new movie I'm doing is not going to let me wrestle because we know what happened the last time when he suffered the injury. Now they've got it built in where they can go the route of potentially Asuka or Charlotte Flair or Alexa Bliss, one of those possibilities. I think right now, if I had to guess, and again, this is just my guess, I would say they're waiting on The Rock's availability, and if he can do it, that is your match. And if that is not the match at WrestleMania, it's not because WWE decided to go in a different direction creatively. It means it's because The Rock couldn't do it and said no.
Well, and look, let's take the MMA approach here, and just wrestling in general. This has been used all along. When you, I do agree, and I understand business when it comes to the fact that, look, when you have a massive main event guy like a Rock on your card or whatever, then it helps everybody else on the card. You know, I mean, just it's take the boxing approach, take MMA. It doesn't matter when Brock Lesnar's on top of your card, everybody benefits, everybody gets a bigger payday. When Tiger Woods is on the golf course, everybody gets a payday. They get a bigger payday because more people freaking watch. So at the end of the day, WrestleMania, and that is the ultimate punchline. That's what WWE cares about. How many people can we get to watch WrestleMania every single year? Because overall, that helps everybody else that's on the roster because they're being seen by more people on a bigger stage. You don't have to necessarily think about it as Charlotte has to be in that position, and I get that. If Rock, and because it does tie into the first time she made that appearance at WrestleMania, if Rock is available and you can do Rock and Ronda Rousey versus Triple H and Stephanie, that's a great match. I mean, that'll be an interesting match to watch. It'll be fun to see, and I think that's a no-brainer. Now, if you don't get The Rock, I think this would be a better route to go with someone like Braun Strowman than putting him against The Miz, which we've also been rumored. And now that kind of segues us into the other main event of last night as well, of course, with the triple threat. Brock retained over, which I thought, look, I mean, really wasn't a bad match in my mind. I thought they did some really cool things. I thought it was brutal in a lot of ways. In fact, it even got a little heated in a couple of exchanges between Brock and Braun that everybody's reporting on today. Some stiff shots there by both men. And look, I think Braun Strowman, you've got to be careful here, man. If Brock versus Roman is where you're headed now, you've got the Elimination Chamber, please just don't. And they view Braun 1,000 times more, you know, on a higher level than they did like a Ryback. But let's not forget kind of some options and some ways that this can go down. A guy like Ryback had a ton of steam and then gets immediately just, they're done with him in a matter of like 2 months. And everything came crashing down after that. I don't foresee that for Braun right now. They are so high on Braun, which is why I think after last night, no harm done. He looked strong. Brock looked strong. Kane didn't look bad, but he was just kind of, again, he was that role player to take the pin.
Yep.
Brock goes on, whatever. Brock came back looking decent in this as well. Braun still comes out of this looking strong. Going and putting him up against The Miz makes no sense to me. If that is really on the table as an option, please don't go that route. Not because I don't love Miz in the role that he's in, but Nick, to me, I don't think fans, and I certainly am one of those, that doesn't think Braun gets anything out of this by putting Miz on his level, you know, as far as that goes. I don't think Miz gets anything, even though they're wanting to give him, it's being reported that they want to give him a huge push, and I like that. I think Miz deserves that, and he's great in the Intercontinental Championship role. But Braun shouldn't be there with him, in my mind. So let Miz go a different direction. Let Braun go a different direction. Braun versus Triple H has never really been followed up on. That made a lot of sense. Even as a one-on-one match at WrestleMania, I could get behind that if it's not a Braun versus Brock or Braun versus somebody massive. I mean, it's got to be in that. Hopefully they don't go like a Big Show route. If Rock can't make it, I think I would much rather, the way with this report coming out, I think Braun gets a lot out of that match. You know what I mean? If the Rock can't make it, I think Braun is elevated on a high, you know, on a major stage like WrestleMania, up against one of the bosses and the main boss's daughter and Ronda Rousey. And look, I mean, Braun could they need to continue going the way they're going with him. But if that match doesn't happen, or if The Rock can be there, or if Ronda goes on to face Charlotte or Alexa or whoever, where is Braun going from here, Nick? Like, that's my concern at this point. Like, yeah. Where can Braun go from here if it's not Brock Lesnar? If it's not that four, you know, that tag team match kind of celebrity style type of main event, like where does he go? Like, it's really hard for me to picture that.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because you have Braun Strowman and Roman Reigns really going in the same direction. You know, these are the two top baby faces right now that WWE is really sort of pushing as these indestructible forces, you know?
Yeah.
But you can only have one, you know, in the main event spot, sort of, you know, you can't, I mean, I suppose you can be booking matches. I mean, who knows after WrestleMania, could we be seeing triple threats? Could we be seeing, you know, looking ahead even to SummerSlam? Could we see Braun Strowman versus Reigns versus Lesnar for the title? Where, you know, Reigns has to defend the title against these two monsters.
Yep.
I could definitely see that happening. But it's just, it's the way the pay-per-view match last night ended was, remember, with Braun Strowman looking at Brock and saying, "You never beat me." You didn't beat me. Now, I guess we're supposed to casually forget the fact that Brock Lesnar rather easily beat Braun Strowman just a few months ago at a pay-per-view. But again, that's one of those things where, you know, if WWE doesn't want you to remember it, then it never happened. So, you know, and I think Braun has been on such an insane roll since then.
I think people have forgotten about it, really. I really do.
That loss isn't really meaningful to me.
100%.
You know, I'm not dwelling on that. I don't think anybody else is. But it's a good question. I mean, really, where is he going? I mean, this is a guy that took apart a whole stage. You know, this is a guy who they've been selling as an absolute monster.
And, you know, and WWE does not do a good job with monsters often. Like, they really don't. Like, when they book somebody...
They don't because they typically give up, first of all. But second of all, if this is a guy who we've seen do everything he's done on television, and you're saying Triple H or even a Kurt Angle are high-profile opponents, which they are, how am I supposed to believe that Braun Strowman won't just obliterate an older guy like Kurt Angle?
Well, he would.
Triple H,
I mean,
not in the prime of his career.
Yeah.
Triple H is an executive. Triple H is nearing 50 years old. Braun Strowman should easily, if he can destroy Kane and Brock Lesnar in a match, if he can rip apart a whole Raw set, if he can flip over a friggin' production truck, he should be able to easily beat Kurt Angle, right?
Yes. Now, Triple H, I don't think the perception of Triple H is that he's a decrepit man, like necessarily people might look at Kurt Angle that way.
I guess, okay, let's look at it instead of what is the perception of Triple H and Kurt Angle. What is the perception of Braun Strowman right now?
No, I agree.
They are positioning this guy to be Superman.
Right.
Indestructible Superman.
And the fans are digging it too, man. The fans are behind
him. In the corner a little bit?
Do what?
Is that backing him into a corner a little bit?
No, it always is, and that's the problem. Look, you've got to cash in on this one of these days. Like, to me, you've done this so well. Let's go back to Andre the Giant days. Let's put the damn title on him, and then let's get your big, massive baby face run or whoever. Like, eventually, try to turn him heel. Yeah, exactly. And let's put the title on an indestructible force at some point and then allow your big babyface hero to come and you know, even if it is a guy like a Daniel Bryan size, you know, like someone that is organically getting over, that can come in and use a speed or quickness and agility and smarts to get over on it. The biggest problem is you normally don't see it this way. You normally don't see a monster of this magnitude and then pushing him as a monster get over. Normally he's the heel. And so it's easier for them to justify having him take that massive loss early. The fans are behind this guy, and so it's a lot harder for them to say, well, let's give up on this. We can't do that. So yes, it's okay to do it with Brock. Let's give Brock a rub, but you didn't really, you know, that's why Kane was obviously there. So this is kind of like, in a sense, uncharted waters. I mean, they really aren't familiar with this, with having the fans cheering for a guy that has been indestructible up to this point. And so, yes, they're in a tricky situation, but I want them to capitalize on it. I don't know what's happening with Brock Lesnar after Mania. That's why I'm really upset with the fact that, look, here's the thing. Give Roman Reigns the title. Fine with that at this point. Let him go full-fledged heel, man. Like, eat up. Don't, like, let him take that route. You've got enough merchandise being sold now. Don't give me the old John Cena reason for why you can't do it. Let him go that route. Let Braun Strowman come in and actually chase, which is really an interesting concept to me, and let him come and eventually square off against Roman, give him that run, and then give another guy the opportunity against maybe Braun, excuse me. So, like, I don't know where you go from here, but I feel like it's going to take somebody better than The Miz. That matchup with Ronda Rousey, maybe with Braun in the mix there, is interesting. Tonight could be a decent indicator. That's why I'm looking forward to tonight's show. The Monday Night Raw after a pay-per-view is always interesting to see kind of where they're going to go, especially after the Rumble, how they're going to get there. I heard in the chat room somebody was saying that they were going to have some qualifying matches for the Elimination Chamber. Nick, I assume at this point you have to have Braun in that, right?
You that's already been announced.
Yes. Oh, has it? Okay. So, well, who are the match? Who is it then?
What
do we know?
Remember, these are matches to qualify for the Elimination Chamber, which takes place next month. You've got Woken Matt Hardy facing Elias.
Interesting.
In that case, honestly, I see Elias moving on.
Yeah, me too.
Elias is on a roll. He was great last night.
Man, he's good.
Personally, just to interject, I think Elias's attack on Heath Slater was the best one.
Yes, it was.
He was doing it while he did it while he was playing a guitar.
Right, right.
Very impressive. Yeah. Not easy to do.
Yeah, that's true.
I've done it before. I've attacked a guy before playing a guitar. It's hard to stay in tune.
Good point.
John Cena versus Finn Balor.
Yeah.
Which I think could be just a fantastic match. Also playing off the Royal Rumble a bit last night.
And I think Finn goes over there.
And I think he has to. I think he really
I think John Cena is on a point, like almost too much so, where he's like, look, I'm a guy that can put other, like, please like me. I'm going to put over other people. And I think he's on this mission to prove that he's not burying people, even though I don't think anybody thinks that now. But
I've never always, and this is another thing I actually liked about last night's Royal Rumble match is it's never John Cena's fault. You know, despite, again, everybody always wanting to blame him.
Sure.
Like you blame the women's wrestlers for not having good matches, but it was because they were never trained.
Right, right.
It's booking. Yeah. John Cena has said millions of times, I'm not bigger than this machine. I show up and I do the job they tell me to do. So if he shows up to Raw today and they tell him, you're squashing Finn Balor in a 30-second
That's not his
match,
fault. Right.
That's what he's doing because that's what they're telling him to do.
Right.
So if he will be on board with, I'm sure he would love to put Finn Balor over tonight in a phenomenal 20-minute
And I think he does.
Quality match.
I think he does, yeah.
And I think he does. But if he doesn't,
By the way, just so I know, Nick, just so I know, and you can guys check it on ProWrestling.com, obviously, for all your latest news. But what is it, two separate Elimination Chamber matches? Are we doing that, or is it just a Raw thing?
Well, there are rumors that there's going to be a Women's Elimination Chamber match. But
is the Elimination Chamber is only a Raw pay-per-view, right?
This is a Raw exclusive.
Okay, I got you,
So as what we know now, what's the only thing that's been confirmed is one Elimination Chamber match for the men.
Yep.
And again, Matt Hardy, Elias tonight, John Cena versus Finn Balor, and then Braun Strowman versus Kane in a last man standing match. That's tonight on Raw.
All right, good. Braun goes over. Yep.
Braun Strowman goes over there.
And it's that's a good bounce back for him too. Like, let them follow up with Kane. Kane and Braun, and Braun, Kane will give him a little bit of a run, but I still expect that a 7-8 minute match most likely, and sure. Braun looks really strong there and goes over. I think that's good.
So coming out of Raw tonight, you could see Elias, Finn Balor, and Braun Strowman as the first guys announced for the Elimination
Chamber.
We're
expecting
match.
Then.
There will be six in total. I would imagine it will be rounded out with, of course, at least Roman Reigns.
Have to.
And then, if we want to sort of end here on these predictions, Chris, my prediction then would be Roman Reigns winning the Elimination Chamber match. And then, of course, he would go on to that match would be to determine. I mean, the match, it's already been announced that match is to determine the number one contender to Brock Lesnar's Universal Championship at WrestleMania 34. My prediction is Roman Reigns goes on to win that to set up, of course, the main event there.
And they've got to set up, again, going into that, they've got to have a good way here somehow for Braun Strowman to still come out of Elimination Chamber. Again, looking as strong as he can look.
Well, what do you think? I mean, Elimination Chamber, that's a match made in heaven for Braun Strowman. Right then and there, I picture him destroying that entire chamber.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And then whatever happens there, that could then allow other people to get involved. Remember, The Miz could still enter that match. Something happens in that match with Braun Strowman, Miz, or something could happen with Triple H. It could happen with Kurt Angle due to Braun Strowman's destruction of the whole pay-per-view and the whole main event that could then set up Braun Strowman's WrestleMania 34 match.
Couple of quick notes before we get out of here. Obviously, Raw tonight, guys. Really looking forward to it. Got the Elimination Chamber starting to take shape as of tonight as well. And then, of course, we just got announced that the Jonathan Coachman is coming back to announce. He's taking Booker T's place. So yeah, I know a lot of people probably – I'm going to miss Booker T's – idiotic statement, but I know a lot of people are happy about it. I am too. I think Coachman will do a really, really good job. The Dudleys going into the Hall of Fame is well-deserved, of course. That makes sense, and looking forward to seeing them WrestleMania weekend. Their speech should be a lot of fun, and of course, it makes a lot of sense for those guys to go in there. But, of course, we will be back and next Monday night to talk about everything, the fallout from tonight's show as well. So we really hope you guys will tune in and spread the word, please, of the Voice of Wrestling. We have big things planned for 2018 and beyond. It's already starting to grow. A lot of the stuff that we've been doing to get things out there have really paid off, and a lot of new people starting to come on. So we really appreciate every Monday night, 6:30 Eastern, unless we tell you otherwise, right here, myself, Nick Paglino. We're going to start bringing on some special guests here going forward here before long as well. So looking forward to bringing some guys back on so we can have some roundtable discussions and everything. We'll start maybe taking some phone calls again at some point in the future. We're gonna try out some things. So make sure every Monday you make this one of your destination spots, the Voice of Wrestling. Guys, before we get out of here, Nick and I are actually getting out of here, but earlier I recorded a David Dishes segment with my cousin David. For those of you that are not Voice of Wrestling long timers and don't know a lot about it, he's my cousin. He's an amazing guy. He's had two brain surgeries, though, in his short 17 years. He's a huge wrestling fan, and anytime I get the opportunity to talk to him about pro wrestling, I love doing it. I had some jackass on Twitter try to call me out and call David out in our show from a long time ago. I won't stand for any of it, I promise. Just enjoy it for what it is. My cousin, huge wrestling fan, his own segment here on our show periodically. He's talking about the Rumble from last night. So, guys, if you want, stick around. I'm airing that right now. It's called David Dishes. And until next week, though, for Nick Paglino, I'm Chris Cash. This is the Voice of Wrestling, and we will see you next week.